You're listening to The Voluntary Life, where you can hear ideas for finding freedom in an unfree world. Visit thevoluntarylife.com to connect with the show and hear all past episodes. Here's your host, Jake.
Hi, it's Jake here. Welcome to The Voluntary Life. This is part 7 in the Thinking Rationally series. You can find parts 1 to 6 of this series in previous episodes of The Voluntary Life, and those episodes were 243 to 248. In each of these episodes, I've been talking about a different aspect of rational thinking, and over the next few weeks, I'm going to talk to you about the irrationality of politics. First off, this week, I'm going to talk about why people are so irrational when it comes to politics. Then in further episodes, I'm going to give you some examples and demonstrate all of the irrational ideas that are extremely popular and, in fact, totally mainstream in politics. And finally, I'm going to talk to you about what you can do if you want to think rationally, given the irrational nature of politics all around you. So that's what we're going to be covering in the next few weeks. But first off, this week, I'm talking about the irrationality of politics. I want to tell you about two theories of why politics is such a mess and why governments make such terrible decisions and why there are so many problems or conflicts in the world. The first explanation for this is the problem of political ignorance. The basic idea here is that it costs time and money to gain political information. If you want to understand politics, you have to invest time. You have to read newspapers, listen to speeches, read manifestos, and you have to spend all that time chasing up on what politicians are doing. Are they sticking to their promises and so forth? So it costs a lot of time and effort and ultimately money to be a politically informed person. And as a basic truth of human behavior, people are only willing to accept costs if the rewards for accepting those costs are greater. So in other words, if you're going to spend all this time and effort learning about politics, it better be worth it to you. But the problem is, most people understand that the chance that they will impact government policy is almost zero. People know that they will have very little impact on government policy. They'll have very little impact even on their local MP or their local politician's policies. So if you want to be involved in politics, you've got to learn all this stuff. You've got to find out about all of the political theatre and what everyone's saying and doing. And your chance after taking on the cost of learning all that information, of actually influencing anything, is almost zero. And this is one explanation of how it is that democracies become hijacked by special interests. Because if you think about it, if you're a special interest, let's say you're part of an agricultural lobby, you know that certain tariffs and subsidies, certain policies, will have a huge direct impact on your own benefit. So it makes sense for you to really push the government to do certain things, to subsidize farmers, for example, or put in tariffs against foreign farmers to support a certain kind of industry. And it's a huge benefit to your lobby, to, let's say, farmers or agricultural businesses. On the other hand, for everyone else who's not involved in farming in any way, the effect on them of any one particular tariff or subsidy or policy might be slightly higher food prices or slightly higher taxes. The problem is that for the average voter, do you have time to look into farm subsidies and agricultural tariffs and understand what's going on with all of that? No, you don't. And the benefit to you of finding out what's going on is you might be able to be informed about whether or not you're paying a little bit more for food than you otherwise would do, or whether you're paying a little bit more in taxes to subsidize a certain industry than you otherwise would do. Even if you did spend the time to find out about this little increase in your food prices or increase in your tax, is it worth it to involve yourself in this tiny issue? Because you've got to bear in mind that as an average voter, this is just one of a million similar tiny issues in all these different industries. So can you spend time lobbying the government about every one of these tiny things? No. And there are a million other tiny issues with concentrated benefits and dispersed costs. So is it worth your while as a voter to find out about each one of these things? Does that benefit you? Not really, not enough to put in all of the work that you would need to put in to be informed about this problem. So that's the problem of political ignorance. And there's lots of theories about this. Public choice theory is the sort of academic field that discusses this problem. But that's actually not the really big problem that I want to talk to you about when it comes to politics. There's something in a way that's creepier and worse than the problem of political ignorance, and that is the problem of political irrationality. This is the idea that it's not that democracies fall short because they are hijacked by special interests. The idea of political irrationality is that democracies fall short because voters get the foolish policies that they ask for. Here's a quote from the economist Joseph Schumpeter. He said, "The typical citizen drops down to a lower level of mental performance as soon as he enters the political field. He argues and analyzes in a way which he would readily recognize as infantile within the sphere of his real interests. He becomes a primitive again." So let me explain a bit more about this problem of political irrationality. The idea behind this is that political rationality is costly. Just like finding out information about politics is costly, there is also a cost to being rational about politics. And that cost is that you don't get to believe whatever you feel like believing. If you're going to be rational, you put your belief system at risk every day because you may acquire new information and be forced to change your beliefs. And that is emotionally costly. People don't like being forced to change their beliefs. So it requires effort to be rational about politics. It requires effort to overcome your biases. As a basic fact of life, humans are only willing to pay a cost or undergo an effort if the reward seems to be worth it. And the problem with politics is that everyone understands that the probability that you, individually, will actually influence the outcome of an election with your one vote is almost zero. It's not quite zero, but it's very close to zero. It's a shockingly tiny likelihood that you will have any impact on swaying an election one way or another. And what that means is that when it comes to politics, people don't have an incentive to be rational. You can believe whatever makes you feel good. And unfortunately, what makes people feel good are some very irrational ideas, which we're going to talk about more in further episodes. It might seem like a strange idea to say that people enjoy holding irrational beliefs and prejudiced beliefs and biases, because I think it's very easy to assume that the ideas that you hold in your mind are tools to help you get on in life. So in other words, you know, you think things because these things help you to achieve your ends. But actually, ideas are not just tools. They are an end in themselves. People enjoy having certain beliefs, regardless of the fact that those beliefs are untrue. People have cherished views that they hold for their own sake or for reasons other than the truth. And here's a nice quote from Gaetano Mosca. He wrote, "The Christian must be enabled to think with complacency that everybody not in the Christian faith will be damned. The Brahmin must be given grounds for rejoicing that he alone is descended from the head of Brahma and has the exalted honor of reading the sacred books. The Buddhist must be taught highly to prize the privilege he has of attaining nirvana soonest. The Mohammedan must recall with satisfaction that he alone is a true believer and that all others are infidel dogs in this life and tormented dogs in the next. The radical socialist must be convinced that all who do not think as he does are either selfish, money-spoiled bourgeois or ignorant and servile simpletons. These are all examples of arguments that provide for one's need of esteeming one's self and one's own religion or convictions, and at the same time, the need of despising and hating others." The basic idea here is that illusions are comforting, shattering illusions is traumatic, and putting your illusions at risk is traumatic. But the thing is, we know that everyone is capable of being rational, and in fact, we live in an age of incredible achievement thanks to rationality. We are able to build suspension bridges and the internet and smartphones, and we have vaccines and the countless other wonders of the modern world, which all depend on our ability to solve problems rationally. And in order to do that, we have to throw out cherished ideas when they don't work properly and accept the discipline of testing our beliefs against the real world. So why doesn't this happen with politics? And this is a theory that I'm going to tell you about, which comes from a book called The Myth of the Rational Voter by Bryan, Caplan. Just to explain the theory, The idea is that the way that the vast majority of people use their rational faculty is as a standby faculty that only kicks in if there's a real danger to your own self-interest from being wrong. So the default way of thinking for human beings, it seems to be, is that you will believe whatever makes you feel good about yourself, unless it costs you dearly to be wrong. In which case, you raise your level of intellectual self-discipline in order to become more objective. The way that Bryan Caplan puts it is that rationality remains on standby, ready to engage when error is dangerous. Now that sounds a bit abstract. Let me give you an example which really brought this home to me. The example is that feeling you get when someone says, "Oh yeah, wanna bet?" I remember this a lot from when I was a kid. With my friends, we would argue about something and we would hold strong opinions and argue away, happily voicing our strong opinions and telling each other the other person was totally wrong. And then at one point, someone would say, "All right, do you want to bet?" And when that happened, I remember that feeling when someone would say to me, "Want to bet?" And that feeling would be, oh, suddenly I feel quite alert and quite focused, because having held strong opinions about something, when someone asks you if you want to bet, what happens is that your rationality kicks in and you start thinking, hang on a minute, are my strong opinions actually true? And have I really analyzed these opinions? Here's another quote from Bryan Caplan. He says, "Your default is to believe what makes you feel best, but an offer to bet triggers standby rationality. Two facts then come into focus. First, being wrong endangers your net worth. Secondly, your belief received little scrutiny before it was adopted. Now you have to ask yourself, which is worse, financial loss in a bet or psychological loss of self-worth? A few prefer financial loss, but most covertly rethink their views. Almost no one bets the farm, even if pre-wager he felt sure." So this is the example of standby rationality kicking in. And the idea is that, you know, people are rational about stuff that really could affect their own well-being in a direct way. So this is why the vast majority of people don't believe that if they jump off the top of a building, they're going to fly. Because they know that if they were to do that, the cost of being wrong would be enormous. And so their rationality kicks in and says to them, wait a minute, no, that doesn't work with physics. You cannot fly. Don't be stupid. So they get rid of that irrational belief immediately. But the idea is, if you don't have to actually face the consequences of what you think, then you can just let your irrational ideas run rampant and think whatever crazy stuff makes you feel good. And that is what politics is all about. Your vote is almost worthless. The idea that you're going to be the deciding vote in an election is so unlikely, so horrendously unlikely, that you know you can think whatever you like and vote any way you like, because ultimately you don't have to bear the consequences of your actions. It's not about you, and it's not about your own life and your own responsibility. You're just casting a vote in an election that is way out of your control and very little to do with you. And consequently, the incentive here is for people to act out their worst irrational prejudices, which is what politics is all about. And in the next episode, I'm going to show you some of the worst biases, the irrational ideas that are extremely popular. Bryan Caplan, in his book, lists a number of them, which I'm going to take you through, and they are things like the bias towards pessimism, the anti-foreign bias, the anti-market bias, and the make-work bias. I'm going to explain all these in further episodes. But this week, I just wanted to start by giving you that idea of why politics is so crazy. It's not that people are politically ignorant that's the problem. It's that voters get the terrible ideas that they ask for. The writer H.L. Mencken said, "Democracy is the theory that the common people know what they want and deserve to get it good and hard." If you're interested in this, this idea comes from Bryan Caplan's book, The Myth of the Rational Voter. It's a very interesting idea, although I have to say that book, it's written by an economist for other economists, and it's so filled with unnecessary jargon. I think it's a real shame, because Bryan Caplan actually has some great ideas. I know why he's doing it, because he's talking to other economists. He wants to show them that he's read all their work, and it's a discussion amongst economists in this book. It's very interesting ideas. I just wish it wasn't written in such awful jargon. He also has an agenda, which I'm not that interested in, about showing that professional economists like him are such great guys and how they all think similarly. And I didn't like that aspect of the book. But this idea, nonetheless, comes from that book, and it is a very interesting idea. The Bryan Caplan book is an academic description of this idea of political irrationality. But he's not the only one to have thought of this. And I'll put a link in the show notes to a clip by the comedian George Carlin, where he's really talking about exactly the same idea. I think it's a great clip, so I recommend you watch it yourself. I'll put a link in the show notes. So you can find that there. And you can. I'm also put a link in the show notes to a little talk by the philosopher Michael Heumer, who summarized this idea really well. And he makes the point in that talk that irrationality is the biggest problem facing humanity. The biggest problem that we have is political irrationality and irrationality in general. This is a worse problem than war or poverty or pollution or anything else that you can imagine, because to solve any of those other problems, you have to have an accurate understanding about them. And you won't have that if you think irrationally. So in the same way that quack doctors don't actually help people get better, they just do some random thing that may well end up making them worse, irrational views about social problems can end up making society worse off. So, you know, this is the biggest problem facing humanity, is the fact that people don't use their rational faculties. They use reason as a standby. It's like a last resort. A useful analogy to explain how people use standby rationality is to think about what it would be like if you took a standby approach to healthy diet and exercise. Imagine that your lifestyle is really unhealthy, right? You never exercise, you eat loads of really bad foods, you smoke, you get blind drunk all the time and drink to excess, you're damaging your liver, you're obese, you're really unhealthy, right? And imagine that you go to a doctor's appointment and the doctor says to you, look, you're putting yourself at serious risk of a heart attack and many other health problems in what you're doing, the lifestyle that you're leading. You've really got to change your ways. You know, you're going to kill yourself if you carry on living like this. Now, if you had a standby approach to healthy living, what you would do in response to that message from the doctor is you would try and do the least possible exercise and change your diet the least amount just to stop yourself from getting that heart attack. So you might ask yourself, okay, well, look, what's the absolute minimum amount of exercise I can get away with? And, you know, what's the maximum number of donuts I can eat and cigarettes I can smoke just to bring down that risk of heart disease? What's the minimum I can do? That is how most people treat rationality. That's like our default way of treating rationality. It's not an integral part of our life. It's something you resort to reluctantly if you really have to for your own well-being. The default attitude is to think whatever makes you feel good and then resort to the discipline of thinking rationally only if you really have to, because it's going to be a huge cost to you personally if you don't. That's the problem. To continue the analogy, just imagine what it would be like if we were all to treat rationality in the way that a healthy person treats diet and exercise. A healthy person looks after their body and they do exercise every day and they eat healthy food and they make an effort to treat their body well. They choose to miss out on the comfort of many donuts, and they choose to miss out on the pleasure of many cigarettes. But a physically fit person chooses to take pleasure in the discipline of physical fitness, and to have fitness and healthy living as an integral part of their lifestyle, as an integral part of their values. A physically fit person is not waiting for a doctor to say, listen, you've really got to change your lifestyle, otherwise you're going to kill yourself with a heart attack imminently. A physically fit person is thinking, what can I do to keep myself in good shape for the long term? You know, how can I proactively promote my own health, my own physical health, to the greatest extent possible? What habits are going to help me do that? And a physically fit person has brought healthy living and a healthy lifestyle into their core values. And my invitation is to do the same with mental health. To be mentally healthy, you have to treat rationality as a core value and one of your principles, not as something that you resort to in an emergency situation. Like a healthy person takes pleasure in the discipline of exercise and healthy living, a mentally healthy person takes pleasure in the discipline of rationality. And just like a physically fit person doesn't indulge their desire for donuts, a mentally healthy person doesn't indulge their prejudices and biases and pet beliefs. And the point I'm making is that your choices really matter in how rational you are. Just like with physical health, you can do a huge amount to influence how much you use rational thinking. And you can also do a huge amount to keep yourself in situations where your rational thinking will be promoted and your irrational prejudices will not be promoted. So to continue the example with physical health, if you're healthy, you understand that because of our evolution, you know, we have a strong attraction to eating sugar, basically, processed carbs and sugar. And if you want to stay fit and healthy, and it makes sense not to fill your house with candy or sweets, as we call them in the UK. If you want to promote your own health, you don't buy a bunch of sweets or candy, and you don't buy unhealthy foods and have them on hand. You can make these choices to create the right environment for yourself to be healthy. And similarly, if you want to think rationally, it's a good idea to be careful about putting yourself in circumstances which incentivize your irrational prejudices. And politics brings out the worst in people because it incentivizes irrational behavior. Politics is where people indulge their worst prejudices, because politics is not about your own decisions, your own responsibilities, your own life. It's about massive decisions made by huge impersonal organizations way out of your control. And consequently, it's a great canvas for you to paint all of your worst prejudices on, which is what happens. So if you want to promote your own rationality, don't get involved in political theater, because that's like putting candy in your home if you want to stay fit. There are some irrational beliefs that are harmless when you keep them to yourself. You know, if you like to keep a lucky charm, it's not rational, but it doesn't hurt anyone else. It's your business and nobody else's business. But when you apply your irrational beliefs to other people's business, which is what politics is all about, it's all about forcing others to obey rules that you want to make up for them. When you do that, what you're doing is you're taking out your irrationality on other people. And that's where irrationality isn't just a harmless belief that you keep to yourself. That's where it gets really dangerous. And that's what underpins the worst things about political life and about human conflict. Back at the beginning of the Thinking Rationally series, I made the point that religious faith will interfere with your rationality, and political faith will interfere with your rationality too, because politics really is just another religion. It has all the same trappings of religions. There are holy books, there are places of worship, there are rituals like voting. So if you want to be rational, be very careful about politics, because it's a huge invitation to your worst prejudices. And that's why, you know, we all have to get fit and healthy in terms of the way that we think, in a similar way to, you know, we've got to cut down on crap food and be healthy physically. It's not good enough to just do the absolute minimum that will stop you from having a heart attack. If we want to all work together and cooperate and take advantage of the amazing power of the division of labor, of peaceful cooperation, people have to be reasonable. They have to use rationality. What this series is about is bringing rationality much closer to your core values. So I hope that makes sense. I'd love to hear your thoughts. And I've got lots more to share with you about politics and rationality and what you can do to live a fulfilled, happy, prosperous life using rationality in your own life in further episodes. That's all for this week. Thank you so much for listening. I'll be back next week with another episode.
Thank you for listening to The Voluntary Life. If you have feedback about the show, please email Jake at thevoluntarylife.com. If you enjoyed this program, please share the podcast with your friends or click the donate button on thevoluntarylife.com.